Zeolite Society, and he will be in the presentation.
I've been accused on occasion by friends of being a Welsh preacher, but rarely have I had the opportunity to do so in surroundings like this. One of the problems with zeolites is, as many of you will know, is that they rarely grow in large enough crystals for you to do complete structure identification of them. And in so many cases where we are left with submicron materials, often of unknown structures, we have to resort to combining a number of techniques to try and elucidate the structural characteristics. Some of the more important developments that have taken place in the last 3 or 4 years is the application of silicon 29 and aluminum 27 NMR to look at distributions of atoms within the frameworks of the zeolites, and high resolution electron microscopy in the lattice imaging mode. What the latter has done has shown us that zeolites are nothing like as perfect as we thought they were, and that in most cases, zeolites contain a lot of defects and a lot of intergrowths. The focus of my talk this afternoon is, number one, to indicate the possibilities of using carbon-13 as a probe of unknown structures, and to apply it to this zeolite called ophrodite, which has a great propensity to intergrow with other materials, particularly aerionite. Now, as a catalyst, ophrodite has been much investigated for lubes dewaxing, and in many cases could be viewed as a commercial catalyst in terms of its product, in terms of its activity and selectivity for products. It also has some interesting hydroisomerization characteristics, and so this is a real catalyst, but it's a real catalyst for problems, in that if you take 3 or 4 different kinds of preparations, they will show distinctly different properties. The best catalyst is very definitely the ophrodite, the pure ophrodite catalyst, which is a structure characterized by 12 ring tunnels in one direction in the structure, with very little cross diffusion between the tunnels. What I want to do today is, first of all, with the first slide, discuss some of our work on carbon-13 NMR. A lot of zeolites can be grown. A lot of zeolites can be grown in the presence of a variety of organics. And what the organic does in many cases is template specific kinds of cages. These are different kinds of cages that you find in various zeolite structures. And the ones of particular interest to us here are the zeolite cage, the melanite cage, which is the far end, a combination of the melanite cage, and the very large cages, which in the center one is characteristic of phagocyte. The phagocyte structure is made up of the alpha 1 cage and the zeolite cage. The alpha 2 cage, which is characteristic of zeolite A, which also has a structure formed from zeolite cages and alpha 2 cages. The structures of ophrodite and massite, two of different tunnel structures, are characterized by having melanite cages. Next slide. In the case of zeolite A, we find that if zeolite A is made at low silica levels, it will trap the tetramethyl ammonium template into the zeolite cage, which is the top peak. As we increase the silica to alumina ratio of the A that we synthesize, and these high silica A forms require the presence of tetramethyl ammonium cations in the synthesis, we find that the tetramethyl ammonium locates in both the zeolite cage and the large alpha cage. giving us two quite distinct carbon-13 chemical sugars. And as we increase the tetramethyl ammonium content even further, we increase the solid-to-aluminum ratio and imbibe more TMA into the supercake. So as you can see from the top three spectra, one can manipulate SiAl ratio by specifically putting in TMA, first into the zeolite and then into the large alkylate. In tetramethyl ammonium zeolite, which is also made in the presence at high base levels, in the presence of TMA, there is only one cage. Now what we note about this particular chemical shift for TMA in the zeolite cage is that it is relatively constant regardless of SiAl ratio. And in fact, if we look at a variety of these, we look first of all at zeolite with TMA in a lithium exchange, high silica, zeolite A. We look at TMA in a gallium-substituted pouchocyte, where again it's in a small cage of pouchocyte. We look at a sodium TMA zeolite and a sodium exchange, high silica A, so-called ZK4. We find that there is very little change in the chemical shift for the tetramethyl ammonium carbon. If we now look at two other zeolites that are characterized by maillonite cages, mazite and ophrodite, they're different 12-ring channel zeolites, and therefore the maillonite cages have somewhat different configurations within the structure. We find again there is very little difference between the chemical shift for TMA. And again, as we look at TMA in the large cages of phagocyte and zeolite A, so-called ZK4, there's very little shift, and this is very similar to TMA in solution. So we begin to think that we have a handle, possibly, on the environment of TMA within a given kind of cage structure. If we look at the average diameter of these cages, and some of these cages are elongated, some are fairly symmetrical, and we assume that a mean diameter is equivalent almost to a wavelength, and we're thinking about a TMA being like particle in a box, then we can assign a frequency value to it. And when we do that, we can get a reasonable correlation between the vibration of the TMA and the chemical shift. We essentially begin to develop a probe that is another additive probe to our other tools to possibly indicate within an unknown structure containing TMA a certain kind of cage structure. Now if we look at the, I'm afraid you probably can't see this very well from the back, but basically we're looking at the top, a particular sheet structure of six rings. One can stack these sheets of six rings by rotating them 60 degrees into an A, B, C kind of stacking. And when one does that, one can make, in a fairly pure material, very specific pure materials. And in this case, we have an example of AAB, AAC stacking. And this gives the material called aerionite. However, if we stack or misstack these layers in a different way, we begin to intergrow a whole variety of possible structures. And in fact, the number of structures one can derive from this kind of sheet in different stacking sequences, where one goes up to stacking layers as high as about 12 stacking layers, is something like 240 different structures, if the repeat on the 12-layer sequence is perfectly repeatable. So this kind of system offers the opportunity during synthesis of a great deal of manipulation. And these are basically are the zeolites that one can obtain through various kinds of stacking sequences. Now what I want to focus on are the zeolites ophrodite and eremite. In the case of ophrodite, it's an AAB, AAB, AAB set. In eremite, it's an AAB, AAC, AAB, AAC. And in fact, during synthesis, what one finds is that as one at a given composition reduces the amount of tetramethyl ammonium in the synthesis system, one begins to grow eremite. And the previous thought was that one could only intergrow eremite into these ophrodite structures. If one looks at the X-ray diffraction patterns, there are odd L lines that occur for eremite that do not occur for ophrodite. So that in looking at an X-ray diffraction pattern of a series of these intergrowth materials, one could pick out particular densities of eremite within a given ophrodite structure. Now, to see it in X-ray diffraction, one needs at least about 5 to 8% of the stats to give you sufficient intensity for it to show up in these X-ray diffraction patterns. What was previously thought is that only eremite occurred in these intergrowths with ophrodite. Now, this is the structure of ophrodite. It has AAB, AAB stacking, and it comprises a 12-ring channel out of the board, surrounded by these melanite cages. And this is the site, this is one of the sites for the tetramethyl ammonium cation. The other site in ophrodite is the 12-ring channel. And as we go over here to the AAB, AAC stacking, we lose the 12-ring. As we see here, ophrodite with a 12-ring channel, male neck cages down this column. We block off the 12-ring channel, and we end up with a series of elongated cavities, significantly bigger than those in, than the size of the male neck cage in ophrodite. So that we end up with essentially a series of possible catalyst preparations, or zeolite preparations, where one can control the extent, although not necessarily where in the stacking sequence it occurs, one can control the extent by TMA loading of the amount of eremite within a structure. If one looks at the good ophrodite carbon-13 spectrum, the bottom spectrum is fairly typical of a good ophrodite. That is an ophrodite that has very high capacity for hexane or cyclohexane, has good catalytic properties, has fairly rapid diffusions for n-hexane. And this is compared with the two sites in zeolite A, the very large site and the sodalite cave site. If one now looks at a number of other ophrodites, one begins to see fairly distinct changes in the expected spectrum. And the top one is a material that has, rather than about 8 weight percent hexane capacity, a hexane capacity of about 1%, and very, very poor diffusion properties, and virtually zero catalytic activity. It's blocked, but it's blocked, as we can see, by possibly a variety of tetramethyl ammonium site kinds of intergrowths. And in fact, if we subtract the melanite cage site from the main spectrum, we're left with what appear to be three fairly distinctive carbon-13 beads that could be characteristic of some specific intergrowths within the structure. And again, we can view these intergrowths if we take this AAB, AAB, AAC, AAB, and so on. We can develop a range of possible structures that we've attached an N number to, that is the number of stacks containing the double A sheet. And we can assign essentially a frequency number to them, if you like, a cage size effect. And if in fact we plot these as a function of chemical shift, we obtain an average diameter for the cage, and therefore an average elongation for each of those carbon 13 reflections. So that as we begin to look at these integrone structures in some detail, we can see that from carbon 13 and TMA occluded materials, we can develop a much deeper understanding of the kinds of material we have, the possible defects we have, and if we have an ordered enough array of some of these stack sequence, the possibility of picking out from these integrone species quite new zeolite structures that heretofore we have not been able to recognize in totally pure materials or in natural mineral materials. Can I have the lights, please? One of the problems, of course, with this kind of work is you say, fine, we've established a relationship for TMA carbon 13, chemical shifts in certain kinds of zeolites. There are not that many zeolites that, in fact, imbibe TMA, and those that I've shown are probably 50% of them. One can put TMA incidentally into a series of zeolite structures during growth, so that one can extend this calibration somewhat. But what we would much prefer is to have a species that we can put into a pristine zeolite, not during synthesis, but after synthesis, so that we can make a new zeolite by some kind of synthesis method. Push into it TMA, and then monitor the TMA chemical shift, and therefore come up with possibilities for substructures within the zeolite, and extend that into structural modeling, which one can then extend into generating synthetic X-ray diffraction patterns, which one can then compare with actual powder X-ray diffraction patterns. So it becomes a possible tool in this sequence of elucidating new structures. Now, of course, TMA is a rather large species, and in fact is very difficult to put in, to exchange into other structures. We have tried fairly, in quite a number of experiments, to push methanol into a wide variety of zeolites to extend the same kind of argument using methanol as a probe. And again, they have largely failed with a lot of structures we've tried to do it with. However, the indication is that we can do it with xenon. And xenon is a very excellent NMR probe. And our next step is to encapsulate xenon into a fairly wide variety of structures at high temperatures and pressures. Quench xenon into the subunits within the structures, and then again to attempt to establish this kind of vibration frequency against chemical shift relationship. The whole idea is to add another tool to the array of probes that we have for indirectly evaluating and characterizing an unknown zeolite structure. Some work that was recently reported in England by people at ICI, where they have looked at zorbed xenon in both CSM5 and bornite, indicates that xenon is very sensitive to both cations and SIAL ratio, charge density on the framework. If one looks at a lot of the data that was presented by ICI, the possibility is that xenon may be a little too sensitive. But in the cases reported, the xenon was put into a site where it was quite mobile. In other words, a large channel site. What we are specifically looking for is a probe that we can put into a fairly tight trapping site within the zeolite structures. And there are very many of them. And to be able to characterize these rather macroscopic zeolite characteristics, go in and look at the more microscopic zeolite sites, the subunits, if you like, of the lattice, that you add up to make the whole structure. So we think this is potentially quite a powerful probe as another piece of equipment in the armory that we use to solving unknown zeolite structures.
Variable.
No, that's definitely a variable.
And apparently, as I recall, what they found is you go scan across the pellet, there were considerable differences between the outer part and the inner part. I wonder if that's related.
I think that work was specifically directed at ZSM5.
Yes, it was.
There's been quite a lot of work that has looked at ZSM5 elemental profiles across the crystal. In a lot of natural specimens, one can clearly see zone and then map these large natural crystals to chemical changes during growth. ZSM5, one can control quite the composition reasonably well by additional aluminum during synthesis also. I'm sure it occurs in some of these systems, but these things grow fairly rapidly from homogeneous gels. So most of the kinds of preparations we were talking about here were probably no more than 36-hour preparations. I would say I'd be very surprised if you had a great deal of inhomogeneity within the sample. Although we have just started doing some of this, and it's one of those things that in some crystals you do see it, and other crystals you don't see it.
Thank you.